Well, 3 years ago, Robert Schuller was our guest on this program. Let's take a look back at part of his interview.
I was installed as the senior pastor of the Crystal Cathedral in January of 06. Mm-hmm. I was the senior pastor there for 2.5 years, and I want to thank my father and everybody else who made that possible. But the long and short of it is I have 4 sisters, and they're all involved in the ministry, and they have husbands, and they're all involved. And I just didn't feel it was appropriate to divide the ministry the way they wanted it divided. Mm. And so the bottom line was I believed that it was time for me to leave.
Aren't there some problems associated with that? I mean, Crystal Cathedral itself, for that ministry, if there's not defined succession,
correct.
At some point in time, you look out into the future and say, what's the future?
Yeah. Well, at this point, I was removed from that position to make any decisions about what's going to happen mm-hmm. in the future of that ministry.
Well, he was being very polite. Welcome back. How do you resist?
I'm still very polite. What do you mean?
You're still very polite. I noticed you were being a little cautious with what you're saying. How do you resist now the temptation to say, I told you so?
It doesn't do any good. And life goes on. You know, I'm a firm believer that God puts things in people's lives for a purpose and for a reason, that as pastors, as ministers, we're not going to be here forever. Our ministries are not going to last forever. And
hallelujah.
God puts, yeah, exactly. And God puts certain people in our lives for a particular reason, and we have a particular course we take, and there's a beginning and there's an end. And just because there's an end to something doesn't mean it's over. It's just an opportunity for new beginnings.
Well, I hear the hope in your voice, but there has to have been some kind of grieving here. Here's something that,
you know,
your dad put his life into, and mm-hmm. your whole family put their lives into.
Yeah.
You know, I know you were raised in ministry, mm-hmm. and to see it all go, and go in such a public way, it has to hurt.
My grieving started in July of 08. Mm-hmm. So I've been grieving this whole thing for the past 3.5-4 years.
And you saw it coming.
And on July 8th, no, it was July 9th, 2008, I knew that it was over. It was all over. What the decisions they were making and the directions they were taking. And so I started grieving at that point. Mm-hmm. But so now the cathedral has been sold, and there's still a congregation there. There's a congregation of about 1,100 people that continue to meet there every Sunday. And it looks like they may be moving to another location, and they definitely will move to another location in the next 3 years, but it'll probably be sooner than later. Mm-hmm. There is the Hour of Power broadcast, which could continue. In fact, it is still on Lifetime and Discovery and Trinity Broadcasting Network, Dimension 3. So I don't know what the future is there, but they've started using some of my old material back from 2008. Yeah, and 2007.
Strange for you.
Yeah, it is. I'm watching. I go and I watch it, and I just go, "Oh, look at there! I'm in a robe again."
I used to know that guy.
Yeah, exactly. That's about right. Yeah.
Have you reconciled with your sisters? Is that?
Do you know what? I'm in the process of doing that. Yeah, but it's really fresh, and for them.
Yeah.
For them, it's very fresh and it's very raw right now. They were asked to leave only a few weeks ago, basically. So, like I said, it's very, very... I don't think the timing is right for me to really try to do something there.
Through all of this, how do you come to a point of forgiveness where you let it go?
You know, that's really what this show is all about today.
Yeah.
You know, it's forgiveness. The music's about forgiveness And so I'm really honored to be part of this show and to be able to talk about this, because forgiveness is such an important part. Now, Jesus, it's probably been quoted 100 times on today and probably another 100 times, and that is that Jesus told us to forgive 70 times 7. And we need to do that just in one day. Just in one day. And then the next day, do it 70 times 70 again.
So that happens to you too, huh?
Yeah, because what happens, especially when somebody's really hurt you bad, you know, you've really been slammed. You just constantly, these thoughts come into your mind. And it's like, if only, if this, why did this happen? Why did that happen? And you can just really, if you don't just tackle that every single time and just tell yourself, forget it. Don't go there. Don't be this way. Forgive. And so in the course of a day, you could literally 70 times 7 because those thoughts will come in. And if you don't put those away and say, hey, forget about it, it'll destroy you.
Why is it harder to forgive when you're right?
That's a good question. I think because when you're right, you're the one who's been offended, typically, I guess this would be the answer to that. But it's always hard to forgive when you haven't done anything wrong and you've been a victim. That's really when you need to forgive the most.
What happens when you don't? When you want to hold.
That's the real question.
When you hold on to, I'm right, or I'm victim, or what you did is wrong, and I need justice. And until I have justice, I'm not going to be happy.
That's the key. Number one, you cannot create your happiness around trying to get justice, around trying to make circumstances or situations in your life a certain way. Because believe it or not, we're not in control. I mean, it's really hard for people to get to come to that to grasp with the fact that we are not in control. You know, the first three steps in a 12-step program, anybody who's involved in recovery of any addictions, of any life, deals with these three. I can't, he can, let him.
Right.
Okay? And that's good theology. It's good. It's a good way to live. It's a good way to think. It's a good way to feel. I can't, he can, let him. And so we begin to accept that. We begin our day in thanksgiving for what God has given to us instead of living in bitterness and trying to constantly say, if only this had happened, if only I could do that. And we can start blaming ourselves. And we need to forgive ourselves. There's a lot going on.
That was one of the hardest things I ever had to do, is forgive myself. You know, because I knew. And then you're into a whole different thing there. Anyway, your book. Yeah. I've been in your book all this week.
Thank you.
When you're down to nothing, God is up to something. Yeah. And one of your chapters, you deal specifically with having to lean hard into theology to make sense of what was going on with you. You really had to acknowledge, God, you're sovereign. Yes, you've given us free will, but you're sovereign, and I'm going to lean into you. I can't do this. Well, why is it so important to really just surrender, to say, I don't control, and I'm not in control of the situation, but you can, and I'm going to trust you?
Well, like I said, you can't, I can't, he can, let him, is like, for me, has been a foundation of my life.
Sounds like you've been saying that every day.
I do. Absolutely. I say that every single day. That's part of my prayer for a living.
Well,
I can't, you can. Let me be part of your plan, Lord. And that's really what living is.
That's a prayer my father taught me.
Is it really?
Yeah. Not my plan. God, I want to be part of your plan.
Precisely.
You know, my plans, my expectations for my future are going to be wrong, but yours are going to be right.
Exactly.
So not my plan, but let your plan. Can I be part of your plan? Can I come alongside you?
Yeah.
And it's a much better way to go. You've taken on some real challenges. Not just one cable network, you've got two, which in this day and age, I go, you know, go Robert.
Because
that's hard. It's hard to build one now. How's it going?
Well, we're not building, and we bought ones that already existed, and they're growing.
You still got to build them.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they're growing. They're doing well. And the company is doing great. So I'm really excited about that and the challenges and the opportunities that come along with it. And it's again, the whole concept that if you follow God's will for your life, he's going to lead you into places you never in a million years would have anticipated. But that's what God's all about. God's in the business of taking people who are broken, who are down to nothing. And I was at that place where I was down to nothing. Mm-hmm. And out of nothing, he created something. You know, one of my favorite songs is from the movie Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. It's from The Ashes Come the Roses of Success. And I don't want to sing it for you, but it's a...
Oh, please do.
From the ashes come the roses. From the ashes come the roses. Come the ashes come the roses of success. Yeah. But so there you go. You can applaud me for that one, you know. But anyway, that's how God works. He takes the ashes and he takes when we're down to that nothingness, and from there he builds a life that comes to a point where they recognize the fact they wouldn't be where they are if it wasn't totally due to God's sovereignty and grace and recreation. And that's the kind of person God can really work with.
A lot of Americans right now are going through that. They're going through the loss of a job, mm-hmm. loss of a home. And a lot of people are saying, where do we go now? And what do we do now? What would you tell them to do?
Do anything. Do anything. Wake up that day and do something. Take a walk. Pick up the phone. Go through your Rolodex. Or Rolodex don't exist anymore, do they? That's a thing from the past. You can scroll through your phone list and say, okay, who shall I talk to today? And just start calling people. Do anything, literally do anything. And then what will happen is something will spark, God will move, and you'll have a conversation that you never anticipated. Suddenly somebody will hear something they never heard before, and God will start to move, because It's the old concept where even God can't steer a parked car, which I don't believe. I think he can somehow.
He can move it anywhere he wants to.
But, you know, it's the idea. Even God can't steer a parked car. And so if we're parked, if we're just sitting there in our bedroom or our living room saying, Oh, Lord, please do something for me. Oh, Lord, please do something for me. And we sit there all day long saying, oh, Lord, please do something for me. And we're a parked car. And then we get to the end of the day and say, you know, if only God would do something for me, my life would start to change.
You're getting into a life transformation company.
Yes.
And you're going to do this for people.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, it's a total life transformation company. It's a brand new company that I'm working with. I'm going to be coaching people through life transformation. You know, there's a lot of different areas of life. I think everyone has seen different pie charts of physical, financial, spiritual, family, recreation, those pie charts,
balance.
You know, and a balanced life. But I've never seen a pie chart with, except for the one that I wrote, where you have a circle in the middle of the pie chart. Mm. And the circle in the middle of the pie chart is power. Because then the pie chart becomes a wheel, and wheels move, and wheels change, and wheels transform, and wheels go place. Pies get eaten. Okay?
And wheels move down the road.
So, the power is hope.
15 seconds.
The power is hope, and hope comes from faith, just a mustard seed of faith, and you can move mountains.
All right, Robert's latest book is When You Are Down to Nothing, God is Up to Something. It's available wherever books are sold.